Hey guys, today we're going to answer a very common question that I get in the shop. If I install aftermarket, is it going to void my warranty? This question comes up from time to time, and today we're going to try to answer it. Today we have a 2017 Dodge Ram in the shop, and this is their mid-level, so it's four-wheel drive, and it has the Hemi V8. However, it's pretty bare bones on the interior. It's cloth seats, it doesn't have the fancy shifter or anything, and it didn't have much as far as the head unit came, and it didn't have a factory remote start. So this vehicle, we updated the head unit, so it has Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, and we have an aftermarket remote starter with extended range up to a mile. I want to start the video by saying I am not a lawyer and we're not exactly giving legal advice, but we're trying to help clarify an issue that consumers seem to have. So way back there, you had the Magnuson-Moss Warranty Act, and what that is designed to do is to help clarify what the warranty entails depending on the manufacturer and be very clear and concise to the consumer. So what you can do is, as a consumer, you can actually ask whoever you're purchasing a product from, let's talk about dealerships because that's what we're talking about today, we're talking about cars and trucks, you can actually get documentation from them and see what it entails, because every manufacturer is going to be different. This is where that gray area comes into play. So we had a customer that was concerned with their Volkswagen. They wanted to upgrade their sound system, but they're afraid of voiding their warranty. They were under the impression that if they do anything to the car, warranty is void. So we contacted Volkswagen, we contacted the dealership, and they gave us this document over here, you can see. And we told them what we were doing. And they're like, they asked us, do you cover the part that you're installing? We said, yes. Our manufacturer on parts is 1 year unless they buy the extended warranty, but the workmanship is lifetime. So as long as they own that car, all the connections and all the work I do is warranted for life. So over here, there's contract exclusion. So there's a long list over here, and they also state things like, non-factory audio equipment. So if we were to change the stereo or the head unit and give them CarPlay because they didn't have it, well, if something happens to it, they obviously would not go to the Volkswagen dealership. They would come over to my shop. So that's where I think there's this big misunderstanding when it comes to aftermarket. You would void the warranty for that particular part of the vehicle, for sure. You changed it out. So obviously the manufacturer or the dealership can't warranty an aftermarket part. However, if something unrelated to that happens to the vehicle, let's say I put in a head unit and your wheel bearing goes, the dealership cannot say, well, you put a head unit in the vehicle, we're not going to warranty your wheel bearing because it failed prematurely. That's totally different. So want to help clarify things like that. Now, like I said before, you have to read all the fine print because there might be some manufacturers out there that may say you can't touch anything in the vehicle. Well, some like Volkswagen, they're cool with it, but they're specific on what it covers, what it doesn't cover. So be aware. Okay, so we've gone over a warranty, or when a purchase agreement happens, it's a purchase agreement, you sign off on it. So you have to be aware of what you're agreeing to, and that way you know what you can and can't do to a vehicle. So over here we have our 2017 Ram, and look at it. It's leveled, and it has bigger tires from the dealership. We live in a world where, yes, manufacturers are getting more in tune and understanding consumer demands and wants, but at the end of the day, it's human nature. People want to personalize their vehicles. That's part of the fun of it. You could have a loaded vehicle and it'll have every bell and whistle, but there's going to be a bunch of us out there. If there's 10 other trucks out there, cars out there like it, it's kind of boring for us. So we like to personalize it. That's exactly what this consumer's done. They've leveled it because they like the look of it, and they put bigger tires on because they like the bigger tire look. A lot of these trucks do not have tires this size. So what it boils down to is, how cool is your dealership you're purchasing the vehicle from? I've heard mixed things. I've had one manufacturer dealer, same manufacturer, different dealers. One likes stuff that we do, other ones don't understand it, so they don't like what we do. So if the dealership's cool with modifying your vehicle, then you're going to have an easier time. Now, the other gray area is, who's doing the work? What product are you doing it? Because if you're putting in shoddy product, that's more likely to fail, then yes, you're going to have issues, or you put on a product that no one's ever heard of, then that turns into a gray area where they don't want to cover you. Also, are you getting the work done by a professional? Are you a professional that does the work? Are you having the dealership do the work? Then they're more inclined to take care of the vehicle. If you're just having some random person work on it and they put a quality product in, but they butcher the whole vehicle, Yeah, they're probably not going to want to cover it either. I'm using my install as an example. So we did an aftermarket head unit. You can see the antenna over there for the remote starter, the mic. Here is my remote starter. It is a digital system. There are digital and analog remote starters out there, and I find with a digital system, it communicates a lot better. Even if you have the regular key like this, think about it. The metal key is tucked away here, and there's only one physical connection. It just places in. It's not like a typical key. So it's a computer reading the chip and everything, allowing the tip start to turn the vehicle over. So we are integrating with that properly. We're using product that is designed and tested to work with this vehicle. Now, to give you guys a little bit light on the subject, when you purchase product like this, when they're developing firmwares, because a lot of people are like, oh, well, you can buy the cheap stuff online and it works and it just plugs in the OBD2 and it'll start the vehicle. When you get it from a credible manufacturer, that firmware that might cover, you know, several years of vehicles and several vehicles, it costs about $60,000 to $70,000 to develop. Why does it cost so much? Well, what they'll do is they'll actually reverse engineer the car. They'll take a vehicle like this and then they will test everything and pretty much try to break it. And they will actually on purpose break ECUs and PCMs. They'll replace them, of course, and figure out what they can and can't do to the vehicle. That way they let it go into the market safely. If you get some random product with no backing, doesn't have a lot of years in the industry, yes, you can damage the vehicle and then you're gonna have issues. So let's just say our remote starter causes issues and damages this for whatever reason. Yes, the warranty will be void for this. However, because it's done at a shop like mine and we back up our work, if something were to happen to this because of this, the customer just notifies us, we figure out a solution, have it replaced by the dealership, and we pick up the bill. That's typically what any credible shop will do. Also, looking at the wiring, you can see my wiring blends in with the factory wiring. So we use the same tapes, we loom it, try to blend it as much as possible so it looks like it's part of the vehicle, like it came from factory that way. We try to do that as much as possible. Obviously, this doesn't look factory because it's just here. But the rest of it, you know, we try to tuck up and out of the way, run with it. If you get a vehicle and you pull off the dash and it's just a rat's nest, well, yeah, the dealership is way less likely inclined to try to help you out because someone just butchered their vehicle. Now, if you tell them, like, okay, it was done at Anthony's shop, okay, yeah, I know Anthony. You know, I try to establish a relationship with local dealers to make them feel comfortable when I put my product in. It's obviously in my best interest to make dealerships comfortable with my workmanship so they know I do good work and I'll prove it every time. You know, we'll show the work, we take pictures, we encourage customers to check out our Instagram page. You know, this is what we're working on right now. This is what we're up to. You know, we're always keeping up to date. So when the dealerships get my stuff, they don't really care. They don't just start blaming the aftermarket. You know, they say, Anthony, can you unplug this so we can scan this? I'm like, yeah, sure, no problem. But if you have a rat's nest of wiring in here and it's even hard to remove, yeah, then you're gonna run into issues. So the old head unit was just a standard head unit. I think it had like a compass button on it or something. So this one allows us to integrate with a smartphone and we had the ability to add a backup camera. We had two options for this truck. We could have either put a license plate frame, which we did, or put one in the tailgate. The customer wanted it on the license plate frame, so that's where we put it. Put in reverse. So it works just like the factory stuff. Will you ever get rid of aftermarket? Not really. It's always going to be around, and you're always going to be doing retrofits. So the aftermarket is typically doing retrofits or putting newer technologies in, and then it's this back and forth race between us and the auto manufacturers. Now, you could get this stuff from the manufacturer. I'm not saying you can't. However, this truck right now roughly is about $33,000 to $35,000. I'm in Canada. That's roughly what a truck like this costs. So it's got the Hemi, it's got four-wheel drive, and it's very simple. It does not have LED lights, doesn't have leather seats or anything. Keeps the price down. Now, let's say you want to get a truck with a remote starter and a fancy sound system and things like that. Typically, now they bundle it. So let's say you want the remote starter and the Alpine sound system, but you don't want leather seats. Like, it's a little bit harder nowadays to configure the vehicle specifically because it costs too much. So you typically buy trim levels. One of our sales guys here has a Ram Sport, and that's a $50,000 truck. And what did we end up doing? We ended up pulling out the sound system, and he had factory remote start, but he wanted more range, and he wanted smartphone control, so he wants to be able to have unlimited range with his phone, so we added that in. This truck, they probably spent probably $1,500 in my shop getting the remote starter, backup camera, and a head unit. Didn't do subs or anything like that, but $1,500, parts and labor, all in. So they spent $35,000 plus $1,500. Or you can buy the Mac Daddy model for $50,000. Now, I'm not saying don't buy the top line model. If you want all that stuff, go for it. You do pay a premium. However, performance wise, this truck is going to perform on the road as well as the $50,000 truck. So you have to kind of take it food for thought. The main thing you get though from the manufacturer is consistency. Whenever you buy a fully loaded truck, you know what to expect every single time. When you deal with the aftermarket, depending on the product you buy and who does the work, the results will vary. Now this kind of begs the question, should I just leave my vehicle alone or should I look into modifying? It sounds like a lot of work. Well, if you watch my channel or you're watching this video, you don't mind doing the work. Doing the research, speccing out a vehicle is half the fun of it because we want to make it our own. We have different needs and wants as consumers as we use our vehicles. So setting them up differently is just going to happen. So if someone that's doing contracting might want to have airbags in the back, have a better lighting system, maybe even a sound system and remote start to be more comfortable. Someone that's into off-roading might look into a lift or more performance mods to get through those different obstacles. So really what it boils down to, it's up to you to do the work as far as research goes and figure out what's going to work well on your vehicle and what's going to be safe and who's going to do the work for you. So there you guys have it. Does modifying your vehicle void the warranty completely? No, but at the same time, you have to do your due diligence. Just don't watch this vehicle and say, oh yeah, I can just go get my computer retuned and everything will be okay. They have to look after it. No, you have to read the terms and conditions. And if you're modifying computer stuff significantly and you're causing your injectors not to fire when they're supposed to and you detonate the motor, that's a totally different situation, by the way. Or if you're excessively lifting a vehicle and you're throwing everything out of whack or excessively lowering it, again, totally different story. So it really depends on the dealership and the manufacturer, what you're allowed to do and what they're cool with. Now, keep in mind, think about SEMA. It's the biggest aftermarket car show in the world. And look how many manufacturers show up, including the actual automobile manufacturers. They kind of have to. And the automobile manufacturers are getting onto the performance game. You can buy performance intakes and exhausts from the manufacturer, from the dealer. You can get GM performance, for example, or Mopar performance. So you can change it, but obviously they want their piece of the pie. So it boils down to how the manufacturer, do they allow it? So read your contract when you get it. It depends on the dealer. Are they cool with it? And three, it depends on parts and who's doing it. So are you using quality parts? Are you having someone with experience that has worked on this type of vehicle and the type of modification trying to do? Have they done it time and time again? If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way, at all times, you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus, with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration and informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section, and it keeps applying it to different vehicles. Yeah.